In lesson 5.9, you can start off by activating a hot pack and a cold pack and passing them around the class and telling students that really all that's going on here is dissolving. Each pack has a pouch of water on the inside and a solute that gets dissolved. Depending on the type of pack you get, it could be magnesium sulfate or something else for the hot pack. And for the cold pack, it could be urea or another substance. No matter what it is, the point is that dissolving can cause the solution to be hotter, exothermic, or colder, endothermic. Students then do an investigation to see if they can come up with a good experiment to see which substance causes the largest increase or decrease in temperature of four substances that you give them. The big ideas covered are designing a scientific experiment, that dissolving different substances in water can cause the temperature to go up or down, and whether the temperature increases or decreases has to do with the making and breaking of bonds between water molecules and the substance being dissolved. So students have four different substances that they're going to dissolve and check the temperature. They use potassium chloride, calcium chloride, sodium carbonate, and sodium bicarbonate. They just go through a systematic approach where they use the same mass of each one in the same amount of water, and they first put water in a cup, check the initial temperature, add the substance, in this case potassium chloride, check the final temperature, then they can write the change in temperature and whether it was exothermic or endothermic. For these substances, potassium chloride and sodium bicarbonate are endothermic, the temperature will go down as they dissolve, and calcium chloride and sodium carbonate, the temperature will go up, it'll be exothermic as they dissolve. So we try to give students an idea of why this is happening. Why does dissolving involve a temperature change? This is a little prelude sort of to part of chapter 6, that it takes energy to break bonds, and energy is released when bonds are formed. Now, it's normally dealt with in a chemical reaction, but we're going to apply it to the process of dissolving because it's really the same process at work. So to break bonds requires energy. When bonds are made, energy is released. Now, it's more complicated than that, but we don't get into that too much with students in middle school. You can give kids the idea that to break bonds requires energy, and energy is released when bonds are formed. So what happens when a substance is placed in water and water molecules dissolve it? When the water molecules attach to the solute, energy is released because bonds are formed between the water molecules and the solute. And then it takes a certain amount of energy to break those bonds apart. Energy is required to break the bonds. So it's that balance between the amount of energy released when the solute is hydrated or when the water molecules attach and the amount of energy required to break the bonds. It's that balance that will determine whether the dissolving is endothermic or exothermic. So in exothermic dissolving, there's more energy is released when the water attaches to the solute than is required to break the solute apart. And in endothermic dissolving, more energy is required to break the solute apart than was given off when the water attached to the solute. So on the student activity sheet, students explain this idea of the making of bonds and the breaking of bonds to explain why a given dissolving would be exothermic or endothermic. Now, if you're in an NGSS state, there's a performance expectation, MSPS 1.1, which says develop models to describe the atomic composition of simple molecules and extended structures. Well, lesson 5.9 relates to the performance expectation because students are developing a model of dissolving that can help them understand why particular dissolving might be endothermic or exothermic. If you look at the foundation boxes, students develop a model to describe phenomena. They definitely do that. And they plan and carry out an investigation. That substances are made from different types of atoms, which combine in various ways, and that substances have characteristic physical and chemical properties. Here, students are seeing that different substances dissolve in water in a characteristic way, either endothermically or exothermically. And not only that, but the degree of temperature change is different depending on the substance. And for cross-cutting concepts, scale, proportion, and quantity, students can look at the submicroscopic level at the atoms and molecules that a substance is made of, and use the interaction between water molecules and different solutes to explain the macroscopic observations they have of temperature change. That's looking at things on different scales in order to understand them better. So thanks for watching, and good luck with the lesson.